Hi guys, my name is Anuj Jindal. Welcome to my channel. Today I'm going to start with the first lesson on management, which starts with organization theory. Organization theory, or let's say management, can be divided into three parts: organization theory, organization behavior, and human resource management. All these three combine together to form the study of management. We are going to start with management, with organization theory, in this particular chapter. And then we'll move forward and talk about organization behavior and human resource management in the lessons to come. If you have not subscribed to the channel, do subscribe to the channel immediately. That will give you an opportunity to go through all the topics that I have been covering for the examinations that are coming up. So without wasting any time, let's start with the session on understanding what is an organization. As you can see here, organization theory has been divided into these following chapters. So a total of 7 chapters subdivided into various parts. In this particular lesson, we are going to focus upon what is an organization. Then we will move towards what is management. So organization, in short, probably, let's say Apple is an organization. Management would be how Steve Jobs, Steve Wozniak, or various other people, Tim Cook's now, how these people are managing the organization would be called as management. Organization theory and design is the study of organization as a whole, about which we will be talking. There are various theories on organization theory: classical, neoclassical, behavior, social systems, modern, and contingency. These are different theories or different approaches on how these theorists considered an organization, or how they read an organization. Then you have organization structures, which are very, very important. Regularly, you have questions being asked from this. And finally, we talk about organizational goals, effectiveness, and environment interface, which is very important, regularly being asked, because it is a developing theory or a developing study. Okay. The course has been divided, as I said, into three parts: organization theory, organization behavior, and human resource management. The focus of everything that I teach you and everything that you read is going to be on two things. Number one, to understand a concept, and number two, to identify and remember keywords as well as definitions, because they are directly or indirectly asked in the examination. Okay. So let us start with the first chapter, which talks about an organization and tell us what exactly is an organization. An organization, if you consider, let's take the example of Apple. How did Apple develop into an organization? Two people, only two people, Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak, decided to come together and create something new which did not exist. So it's about a group of people who come together for a particular well-defined purpose. So the purpose was to create a new set of computers which were home-based, which would be home-based, which was not a reality at that point of time, to come out with a new product. Therefore, the purpose was well-defined and particular and specific. And they are ready to contribute their efforts towards certain goals. So Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak, two people coming together, deciding, okay, let's create computers which can be given to people at their homes and which are not limited for industrial uses. And in order to achieve this goal, we are ready to dedicate our lives, dedicate our time and effort, and ensure that this goal comes true. Therefore, an organization is born when people combine their efforts for some common purpose. Common purpose here being developing home-based computers, or developing more advanced and higher quality computers. And they are ready to combine their efforts. The efforts being Steve Jobs being the marketing expert or the sales guy, and Steve Wozniak being the tech guy. Okay. So this is what an organization is. This is how it is born. This is the example that I've explained here as well. An organization, as I said, has certain characteristics which can be brought down into points out here. First of all, there needs to be communication. So if Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak are not communicating on a regular basis, then developing or sustaining the organization of the company Apple would not have been possible. Cooperative efforts, they need to identify what are their strengths and weaknesses and work together for the benefit of the organization. If Steve Jobs would have said that, let me work on the tech part because I want to learn tech part, and Steve Wozniak would have said, okay, I already know how to create a computer, let me try and learn how to sell computers, it would never have worked out. So there is always a cooperative effort that makes their dream come into reality and create a successful organization. Common objectives. The objectives have to be common for all the team members. The objective in this case was to create better computers for homes. And they have certain rules and regulations of their own. For example, in Apple, the number one rule that they had, that they always had, was never to compromise on quality. And it even stands now. You compare with a OnePlus with an iPhone, you would always see that the quality of hardware as well as software of an iPhone, as well as the durability and looks, everything is far superior to a OnePlus. No matter how expensive a OnePlus can be, an iPhone could never be beaten. So there are certain rules and regulations which guide the way that the organization takes. Okay. This is what has been explained here. An organization comes into existence and then continues because people are in a position and willing to communicate. So they are both in a position to communicate and they also are willing to communicate. They want to communicate with each other. Okay. We will be talking about communication as a separate study later on when we get into organization behavior. Secondly, they're willing to cooperate with one another for achievement of their common goals. That's important here. And the existence of common objectives is a must. Otherwise, your efforts are going to go into different directions. Okay. And lastly, there are supposed to be specifically laid down rules and regulations so that there is a formal structure of relationship and communication among the team members. Now, having understood the elements of an organization, let's talk about organization as a system. Organization can be understood as an open system as well as a closed system. In the 1960s, 1970s, it was broadly understood as a closed system wherein only the internal members of the organization, let's say employees, let's say the HR department, let's say the machines that are there, okay, let's say the finance department, only the internal relationships among the organization were in contact with each other. But when we talk about the organization as an open system, we talk about a lot of things, a lot of relationships that go beyond an organization. For example, the government. The government is always consistently in contact with every organization in the country. Whatever policies they make affect every organization. Let's say we go to regulatory agencies, we go to suppliers, we go to customers. All these are external environmental factors which directly impact and are impacted by the organization. So organization can be understood as a closed system or as an open system. But for our study, organization as an open system becomes more important because that is a reality today. So there are three major subsystems. You have input, processing, and output. Let's take an example to understand this. Let's take a service organization, which is more difficult to explain. For example, you go to a barber shop. Okay, you go to a barber shop. The input system here would be the barber who is going to cut your hair. The processing would be the activity of cutting your hair and grooming you, and the output system would be the result of either your satisfaction or dissatisfaction that is going to be a result of the processing and the input system. Okay, it's easier when I take an example of a product and explain this. Let's say there is a factory of Parle. The input system here would be all the raw materials. Okay, the input system where here would be all the employees which are going to work. The processing system would be their efforts. The processing system would be all the machinery that is going to be placed, which is going to create Parle biscuits out of the raw material, and the output would be the packed Parle material itself. Okay, so all these three systems are a part of both open and closed systems. As you can see here, you have an input, you have a processing system, and you have an output. These three systems are linked to one another, and the entire system is linked to external environment, making it an open system. So these three are normally a part of closed system, but when these three get linked to the external environment, then it becomes an open system. A closed system ignores environment as an element, as I explained. I think you must have understood it by now. There are three terms that define organization as a system, not the definition of the organization that I gave before, that was the elements of the organization as a whole, but these three terms are determining organization as a system, whether it's closed, whether it's open. Synergism, interaction, and interdependency. Synergism means, in Hindi, we say that 1 plus 1 is normally 2, but when 1 plus 1 becomes 11, ek aur ek 11 ho jate hain, then you have used synergy, or you have identified how to be synergistic with the other person. That means two people coming together and making the effort and getting the output of 11 people. That is called synergy. It's not only addition, it's coming together of two forces in order to produce an output that is far more than the output produced by two people. Synergism means working together. Going back to the example of Apple computers, when Steve Jobs and Wozniak decided to work together, they created a system of input, processing, and output which was non-existent before. And because of that synergy, they could actually do the work of 11 or even more people in reality, and that is how they reached where they did. The second one is interaction. There is constant interaction among these subsystems. Input, processing, and output, all these three are constantly interacting with one another. The example is, there is an untrained human resource. The processing system has the responsibility of training this human resource in order to ensure that the output is enhanced. Okay, the input here is untrained human resource. So if there is no constant interaction between the input and the processing system, the output system is going to fail. The third one is interdependency. Without the input, the processing would not work. Without processing, output would not be reached. And without a defined output, input and processing would get lost. If you don't know that you have to create Parle biscuits, the input and processing would not know what to do. So the machinery, the human resource, everything would go waste. So this is how interdependency comes into play. There is a fourth subsystem which works in the case of an open system, that is environment. And it comes into play in open systems only, which means that the company, the subsystems of input, processing, and output, all these three are directly and constantly in touch with the forces of environment, and their outcomes or their forcefulness is dependent upon their interaction and their synergy with the environment. For example, Mahindra electric cars. Now there is a big push towards producing better electric cars. The government is also giving a push through various government initiatives like FAME II, for example. The purpose of all of them is to provide political and government support to encourage that the input, processing, output system of the Mahindra electric becomes more efficient, becomes more profitable, so that they're able to survive in the competition of automobile industry. That can happen only when the government provides substantial support to these kinds of electric companies. Now let's understand the micro and macro perspective of an organization. In short, micro perspective deals with organization behavior, and macro perspective deals with organization theory. So the micro perspective talks about people in the organization. So in Apple, when we're talking about all the employees plus Steve Wozniak and Steve Jobs or Tim Cook, then we're talking about micro perspective. Whereas if you're talking about organization as a whole, Apple as a whole, or Patanjali as a whole, or Microsoft as a whole, then we're talking about macro perspective, or what we normally understand as organization theory. I hope it's very clear. There are different kinds of organizations. Organizations can be based on structure, on function, on relations, whether it's formal or informal. Organizations can be based on size, small, medium, large. There are different ways in which organizations can be classified. Here, let's understand the basic types of organizations. If we classify them based on function or purpose, then they can be economic, political, so on and so forth. Economic means they are focused on generating profits. Political means they are focused on providing service to the society. If they are based on relations, they can be formal relations in the organization. They can be informal relations between the organization. A very good example here would be, you must have heard about it in Mumbai, in I believe Juhu or some other beach, a group of people have come together and they decided to clean the entire beach, and they did it. It became a reality. But the relationships among these people is still informal in nature. It's purely volunteering. There is no hierarchy. There is no formal relationship. So it can segregate, it can disintegrate, it can break down anytime. But if we create an organization out of it, which has a formal relationship structure, let's say an NGO, then the chances of that organization or institution breaking down would be much less, almost negligible, unless they go out of money or they don't survive because of some external reasons. So that's the difference between formal and informal organization. Based on structure, they can be traditional, they can be contemporary. Traditional would be line and staff. Functional, we'll be talking about this when we talk about structures in organization in detail. I'll be talking about this through enough examples. So let's just revise everything whatever we have read today through certain questions, and then in the next lesson we'll take it forward. The question says, organizational perspective can be divided into micro and macro perspective. Which of the following are the features of macro perspective of an organization? Macro perspective means organization theory, management or organization as a whole. Okay, so here you have, it is concerned with organizational goals, structures and design, which is correct. It is concerned with human psychological behavior. No, this is the arena of organization behavior, which is micro perspective. It considers organization as a unit of analysis, which is correct. It does not consider humans as unit of analysis. This perspective has a recognized discipline called organization behavior. No, it is organization theory. So only A and C are right, which is option 4. Next question is, type of organization which is developed automatically without any authority is called. I just gave you the example of such an organization taking place or being created on Juhu Beach or some beach in Mumbai. The answer is 4, informal organization. So that's all for today's session. In the next session, we'll take it forward, talk about a lot more things related to organization theory. Till then, all the very best. Take care.